secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
They all come for violence with faces pressing forward,
They gather captives like sand. At kings they scoff, and of rulers they make sport. They laugh at every fortress and heap up earth to take it. When they sweep by like the wind, they transgress and become guilty. Their own might is their God. Are you not from of old, O Lord, my God, my Holy One? You shall not die. O Lord, you have marked them for judgment. You, O Rock, have established them for punishment. Your eyes are too pure to behold evil, and you cannot look on wrongdoing. Why do you look on the treacherous and are silent when the wicked swallow those more righteous than they? I will stand at my watchpost and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Make it plain on tablets so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Through the gospel.
For this gospel, I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. And for this reason, I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me, in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good or a bad omen, but I'll just pass it on to you because that's the way my life seems to be. to work. We've all seen those tiny little seeds, the tiny little mustard seeds. Of course, noticing how small it is important to understand what our Lord is teaching here. The apostles, they come up to Jesus, and they say to him, increase our faith. In other words, we want to add more faith. And Jesus' reply is, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Our Lord uses this moment to talk about what faith is and what faith is not. So let's think for a few minutes this morning about what faith is. Undoubtedly, there's been a time in every one of our lives where we faced a difficult moment. There was a heavy burden that came our way, and we weren't quite sure what to do. And we thought something like to ourselves, if I only had more faith, I would know what to do in this moment. I remember several years ago, I visited a family. Their daughter was in the hospital. She was sick. The doctors weren't quite sure why. The parents were obviously very upset, but the conversation took a turn I didn't expect. They came to believe that somehow their daughter's illness was a result of their lack of faith. Bad things were happening to them, they thought, because they didn't have enough faith in God. No, I said, that's not the way this works. But just imagine for a second how that must feel. Imagine how bad that must feel to believe that your child is on death's doorstep because you didn't have enough faith. As I talked to them, they quoted this very passage back to me. If only they had faith, even just the size of a mustard seed, then their daughter would be made well. So my question to you is that what Jesus is getting at in Luke 17:6? Is that what Jesus is trying to teach here, that if you can just muster up enough faith in any situation, well, then you'll have success, and you'll be able to do incredible things? The answer is obviously no. That's not what faith is. It's not what our understanding of faith is in the Christian tradition, even despite the fact that some of the largest churches in America teach that that is what faith is all about. If you have enough faith, they will tell you, you can muster it up, and you will have success. But that's a perversion of what we mean by faith in the Christian tradition. So famous Lutheran pastor Paul Tillich, he was a very prolific theologian, and he once said that he thought faith was the most misunderstood word in the Christian vocabulary. And I think he might have been right about that. You see, the problem with this view of faith where we tell ourselves, if I can just muster up enough faith here, well, what it does is it makes God's power to act dependent on us. And God was around, acting, and doing great things in this world a long time before you and I were. So remember that Jesus intentionally uses this little bitty mustard seed, the kind of stuff that you have on your sandwich day after day. It's tiny, and what Jesus is saying to us here is it's so tiny in order for us to remember it's not about us. Faith isn't about you. It's not about what you can do. It's not something that can be measured. Faith is a direction that we face in this life. So if we read Jesus' words in the wrong way, where faith is something that can be measured, then we get into all these kind of difficult situations. You know, if I got five measures of faith on Wednesday, You know, that'll be enough for God to cure my cold, but it sure won't be enough for God to cure my COVID. Right? This is a perversion of the way we understand faith. And this type of thinking, it isn't healthy, and it's obviously not what Jesus has in mind in this passage. Okay. So if that's not what he has in mind, then what does he have in mind? Well, I went and read about this week. I kind of searched through a lot of the sermons that the early church fathers had given on this passage. And one of the things that comes up as a constant theme is noticing the choice Jesus makes to describe a mulberry tree here. And they all say, they seem to agree that noticing the mulberry tree is important. Critical, they say, to a proper interpretation of what Jesus is teaching in Luke 17:6. Remember the church fathers, they're those guys that are teaching and writing at the time while the Bible is being compiled in the first centuries of the church. And they spent their lives reading and rereading and rereading the scriptures. They say, they agree, that when the Lord talks about a mulberry tree here, what he's talking about is sin. It's deep-rooted sin in our lives. The sins that we really want to get rid of, but they just seem to hang on and persist, and we can't quite shake them. St. Augustine, this is what he says. St. John Chrysostom, this is what he says, that Jesus doesn't accidentally select the mulberry tree here. He does it very intentionally, and that it serves as an allegory for sin. The mulberry tree is the tree that silkworms feed on. And in the Bible, worms feeding, well, it represents hell. Jesus, in the 9th chapter of Mark's Gospel, he says that hell is where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. And so the worm feeding on the mulberry tree, it represents sin, it represents hell, it represents separation from God in our lives. Now with this idea in mind, when we go back and we read Luke 17:6 again, you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted. Then the teaching takes on a completely different meaning. Faith the size of a mustard seed can uproot sin. Faith the size of a mustard seed can free us from the little hells that we bring upon ourselves day after day through our choice to sin. When we understand faith this way, faith is the orientation then of a person towards God. It's us facing in God's direction day after day. It's us looking for Him. It's us listening for Him. It's saying every day, I want to know you, God. And God takes that. He takes that desire within us and He draws us in. And He helps us to overcome all the things in our life that are hurting us, the sins that we choose day after day. So faith, then, we might define as a sincere desire to walk closely with God. And even with a little bit of that sincere desire, God starts to move all of the junk out of the way and draw us closer to Himself. The apostles come up to Jesus and say, we want more faith. And Jesus says to them that faith will be the key, just a little bit of faith, to uprooting the sin in their lives. Now, teaching this class over in the parish hall, we've been doing lots of surveys and statistics and all that, and someone sent me a survey that was published this week. It was published a while back. Ended up getting picked up by the Washington Times. And in this survey, there were 30 32 questions that were asked, and 4,000 or so people took it. There were Mormons and Muslims and Jews and Christians, and there were 32 basic questions about the Bible that were asked. Anybody could take this question. And then they were asked to identify what's your faith? What's your tradition? And the results, I have to say, are just really sad and really distressing, because the single group that scored highest, 32 questions about the Bible, the single group that scored highest were self-identified atheists and agnostics. They were better at basic questions about the Bible than Christians. Now, I don't bring this up to be Debbie Downer or negative. I bring it up as a reminder that every single one of us needs to make this a personal goal, day by day, to know God, to know His ways. We have to make this a daily task, to actively resist the things that are pulling us away from God, and to embrace those things which we know draw us closer to Him. We're not just going to draw closer to God by chance. We've got to be focused on this. Every day we make decisions that either bring us more into His presence or move us further away. And so we have to evaluate then, how are we using our time? Are we using our time daily to pray and to read Holy Scripture? To do the things that we know will bring us closer to God? Because if we're not doing this, what we're doing is really antithetical to the life of faith. We're orienting ourselves, or we're allowing ourselves to be oriented away from God. And we are all in this onslaught of the world's messages that come at us every day, and if we're not careful, they will naturally lead us away. They will orient us towards all kinds of other things than God. Jesus, in this passage, is inviting the apostles to the life of faith, inviting them to uproot the sin from their lives, to quit holding on to their favorite sins, to orient themselves towards the life of God, and then to begin to take that next step closer to Him. And so when we have even a little faith, our eyes are opened. We're saying to God, we want to know You. And then we begin to see Him working all around us, all the time. If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted, and yet will obey. pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Justin of Canterbury, Francis of Rome, Bartholomew of Constantinople, Gregory and Foley, our archbishops, Ryan, our bishop, Fanuel, Bishop of Northern Malawi, John, Robert, Scott, William, Matthew, and Travis, our priests, and for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease, and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the life of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this congregation, that we may be delivered from hardness to heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have committed themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray especially for our ministry partners of Shona House Seminary, Community First Village, Grace, Gainesville State School, and Union Gospel Mission. And for all who in this transitory life are in sickness, especially Craig, Terry, Sarah, the Nelson family, Christy, Nancy, Haley, Sunny, Eve, Lisa, Sarah, Jessica, Roxanna, Tom, Mike, Diana, Sarah, Eve, Holly, Kendall, David, Nora, Peggy, Barbara, Grandma, Sarah, Dan, those who are in sorrow, the Nelson family, the Hicks family, the Lapena family, the Hodges family, the Heiserman family, the Sullivan family. We ask you to sustain all of any other needs, especially Karina, Linda, the Strayer family, Aiden, Mike, Corina, Hayden, Rob, Kelly, Susan, the Dwyer family, and any others you care to name. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, remembering especially Wesley, Jim, Ed, Jacob, and any others you care to name. And those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Lawrence, and all the saints, let us commit ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord, our God.
For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins, through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, give you in eternal life.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be, keeping them unspotted from the world. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them if discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may your peace, which passes all understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Andrew and Catherine Marshall are celebrating 11 years of marriage. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for the marriage of Andrew and Catherine. We ask that you would continue to give your Holy Spirit more and more into their hearts, binding them more closely to each other, that their life together may continue to be a reflection of the love between Christ and his church. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Next Sunday evening, a week from today, is when the Anglican Essentials Adult Confirmation class begins. You can see that in the bulletin. That's for anybody who wants to know kind of what are the core tenets of our tradition, and certainly for those who are desiring to seek the sacrament of confirmation. So that's on Sunday evenings this year. It'll be at 5:30 over at 6:45, and hope that any that are in the category of sort of like, why do we do the things we do? And I'd like to know more about all the stuff that happens and what motivates it. That's all the stuff that gets covered in this Anglican Essentials class. First communion classes are about to start as well. So if you have little ones with you who don't yet receive Holy Communion, or you'd like for them to know more about it, bring them to these classes, and they'll get a great introduction to why the Lord instituted the Eucharist and what the gift of the Eucharist means. A little further out, there's a trunk or treat that's coming for families and all kinds of fun stuff. You'll see that there's a note in the bulletin today trying to recruit altar guild members. That's happened. We've had that note in there a couple of times. I'm gathering the note continues because the recruiting efforts aren't panning out quite yet for us. So if you're at all interested, Michelle is right over here, and you can ask her all the questions that you'd like about that. Yes, lots of fingers pointing at Michelle this morning. There are lots of wonderful things happening in the parish. It's at full speed. There's lots and lots of different ways to pray, to learn, to share fellowship, to grow in Christ. And I hope that's something that you'll plug into and grow closer to the Lord through the many different ways that St. Lawrence serves and learns and grows together. All the groups are open to everyone, and we'd love to have everyone jumping in. Sunday school is in full session this morning as well. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving. Make good your vows to the Most High.
Bless.
way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Lawrence, and all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Have mercy on us.
be to God.